Good morning, everyone. Let's worship together. Chosen for us for our memory verse for the month of December is found in Matthew chapter 1 verse 23, and it says this: the virgin will conceive and will give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us. Matthew 1:23.
My heart will sing your praise.
That you are a God that never fails. This Christmas season, I ask that you would be close to those who are brokenhearted, that you would give peace to those who are experiencing fear or strife, that you would heal those who need a physical touch, and that you would be close to all of us as we spend time remembering your greatness in a newborn baby. God in the flesh amongst us at Christmas time and all year round. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Hi, I'm Gloria Jerome.
And I'm Dwayne Jerome.
And we're here to share with you on the second week of Advent. In a letter to some of the first Christians, the Apostle Paul writes, "Therefore, since we have been made right in God's sight by faith, we have peace with God because of what Jesus Christ our Lord has done for us. Because of our faith, Christ has brought us into this place of undeserved privilege where we now stand, and we confidently and joyfully look forward to sharing God's glory."
Today, we light the candle of faith. Sometimes faith is hard. How do we trust something that we can't see? But that's why God sent Jesus into the world, alive, breathing, and human just like us. Someone who could touch us and that we could touch. All our faith starts from that humble beginning. When we look at these candles, the light they give, remember that we didn't deserve a special privilege from God, but He gives it to us anyway, just because of faith.
Then we will read a scripture from Matthew 2:13 in Arabic. وبعدما انصرفوا إذا ملاك الرب قد ظهر ليوسف في حلم قائلا قم وخذ الصبي وأمه واهرب إلى مصر وكن هناك حتى أقول لك لأن هيرودس مزمع أن يطلب الصبي ليغلق.
It is here, in the heart of old Cairo, that many believe the Holy Family found refuge from Herod. After being warned by the angel, the family set out immediately, in the middle of the night. They obeyed because they believed God would provide a way of escape, and He did. Egypt, a land that had once been a place of bondage for the Jews, became a place of refuge for the Messiah. Prepare the way. Prepare your heart to find refuge in the Messiah, and prepare your life to be a place of refuge for others.
Good morning, church. Hey, I hope you have your Bible or Bible app handy and a cup of your favorite hot beverage this morning on this chilly December morning. I'm looking forward to digging into God's Word with you. But first, let me set the stage. There is a classic scene from the first of the Lord of the Rings movies. In this scene, Sam, on the left, is standing at the very edge of his comfort zone, literally. And he makes this statement. This is it. One more step and it will be the furthest away from home I've ever been. To which his friend Frodo, guy on the right, replies, "Come on, Sam. Remember what Uncle Bilbo used to say. It's a dangerous business, Frodo, going out your front door. You step onto the road, and if you don't keep your feet, there's no knowing where you might be swept off to." Well, with that thought in mind, there's a question for you to consider today. What would motivate you to make a journey of 500 miles on foot over rugged terrain? I want you to tuck that question away for a few moments. We'll come back to it a little later. We're in the middle of a series entitled Preparing the Way. You see, Advent is about preparing our hearts for the celebration of Jesus' birth. But in another way, it's also about preparing for his return. Did you know Jesus is coming back? He is, only this time it won't be as a little baby born in the animal shelter of an overcrowded inn or house in Bethlehem, but rather as a conquering hero, coming to defeat Satan and death once and for all, and to take his followers home to heaven with him. So this Christmas season, I'd like us all to walk down these parallel tracks of preparing the way. One track being preparing the way for Christmas, preparing our hearts for Christmas. And the other track being preparing the way for Jesus' return. Today's message is all about our faith journeys. And I'd like to invite you to open your Bibles or Bible apps at this time to the passage that was mentioned in the video from our sister in the Middle East, Matthew chapter 2. We're going to be looking at verses 1 through 15. Follow along with me as I read through the passage first in its entirety. After Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea, during the time of King Herod, Magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, "Where is the one who has been born King of the Jews? We saw his star when it rose and have come to worship him." When King Herod heard this, he was disturbed, and all Jerusalem with him. When he had called together all the people's chief priests and teachers of the law, he asked them where the Messiah was to be born. "In Bethlehem in Judea," they replied, "for this is what the prophet has written. But you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For out of you will come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel." Then Herod called the Magi secretly and found out from them the exact time the star had appeared. He sent them to Bethlehem and said, "Go and search carefully for the child. As soon as you find him, report to me so that I too may go and worship him." After they had heard the king, they went on their way, and the star they had seen when it rose went ahead of them until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were overjoyed. On coming to the house, they saw the child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down and worshipped him. Then they opened their treasures and presented him with gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to go back to Herod, they returned to their country by another route. When they had gone, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream. "Get up," he said, "take the child and his mother and escape to Egypt. Stay there until I tell you, for Herod is going to search for the child to kill him." So he got up, took the child and his mother during the night, and left for Egypt, where he stayed until the death of Herod. And so was fulfilled what the Lord had said through the prophet, "Out of Egypt I called my son." All right, let's just make something clear from the outset this morning. Advent and the story of the Nativity and Christmas, it's all about Jesus. In fact, Jesus is the central figure of the whole Bible. Last week, we looked at one of the prophecies in the Old Testament that Jesus fulfilled when he arrived. But there are literally hundreds of prophecies about him in the Old Testament that he fulfilled. He is humankind's greatest need, our deliverer. And we see the depth and breadth of God's love for all humanity throughout the story of Jesus and his birth. In the Gospel of Luke, we read the account of the shepherds out on the hillside. And we're going to get to that story a little bit later in this series. But in that moment, God showed his love for all classes of people by announcing his birth first to the lowest, to the shepherds. And here in Matthew, we see the breadth of God's love as we are introduced to these Magi, these guys from the east. Now, we're not 100% sure who they were or where exactly they came from, but it's pretty apparent that they are not Jews, but rather wise men from a distant country. And their presence in the Christmas story is both a testament to God's love for all people and also to the faith of these men. And we're going to come back to them in just a few moments. But first, I want to go back to the question I asked you earlier. What would motivate you to make a journey of 500 miles on foot over rugged terrain? There are two journeys mentioned in this passage, and we're going to take some time to look at both of them this morning. But let's go in reverse order. And we're going to start by looking at the journey of Joseph and Mary. After the visit of the Magi, Matthew tells us, verse 13, when they had gone, when the Magi had gone, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream and said, "Get up, take the child and his mother, go to Egypt and stay there because Herod is going to be looking for the child to kill him." So that began the journey of Joseph and Mary. Joseph got up in the middle of the night, got his family up, packed their things, and made a beeline for Egypt. Now, if you map it out on Google, the distance between Bethlehem and, say, Cairo, Egypt, is about 500 miles using today's road systems. So it was probably somewhere close to that back in the day. 500 miles. That's a long way to travel on foot, folks. Now, we could probably all do like the first day, but by the second or third day, we'd be hurting. Our lack of training for and conditioning for an episode like that would catch up with most of us. We'd have a tough time making it to day five, let alone 500 miles. I mean, the blisters that would form on our feet in the first 6 hours or so probably wouldn't heal during the course of that journey. We're just not used to traveling that way. Now, Mary and Joseph would have been more used to traveling that way, but that doesn't mean it would have been an easy journey for them either. That kind of journey would have taken at least 20 days of travel one way. I mean, do the math. Averaging 25 miles of walking per day, which is generous, a trip of 500 miles would take 20 days. You have to prepare for a trip like that, especially if you're on foot or camel. You either have to take what you need or you have to take the money that you need to buy things along the way. But Mary and Joseph didn't have time to go to the local Walmart and grab all the supplies that they need. They left in the middle of the night. They had to leave right away. The angel's message was urgent. Herod is going to search for the child to kill him. You know, as I was listening to this passage again just yesterday, this one little phrase jumped out at me pertaining to Herod from Matthew chapter 2, verse 3. It says this, "When King Herod heard this, he was disturbed." That is, when he heard from the Magi the reason that they came, he was disturbed. But folks, let's face it. I mean, the truth is, from what we know about King Herod from history, he was disturbed way before this moment in time when the Magi came to him, folks. He was not a pleasant fellow. BibleGateway.org's article, "Who Was Herod?" says this about him. "Herod was a strange mix of a clever and efficient ruler and a cruel tyrant. On the one hand, he was distrustful, jealous, and brutal, ruthlessly crushing any potential opposition. The Jews never accepted him as their legitimate king, and this infuriated him. He constantly feared conspiracy. He executed his wife when he suspected she was plotting against him. Three of his sons, another wife, and his mother-in-law met the same fate when they too were suspected of conspiracy." So yes, he was disturbed by the Magi's news, because this newborn king they were seeking represented yet another threat to his rule. Listen now to the very next verse in Matthew, chapter 2, verse 16. It says this, "When Herod realized that he had been outwitted by the Magi, he was furious, and he gave orders to kill all the boys in Bethlehem and its vicinity who were 2 years old and under, in accordance with the time he had learned from the Magi." You guys, Joseph and Mary had to flee. What motivated them? Well, they were fleeing, if not for their own lives, then for the love and the life of their child, Jesus. And if there hadn't already been enough clues for Mary and Joseph that this little guy was different, that he truly was the Son of God, this one right here probably solidified it for them. I mean, think about it. Little Jesus, somewhere between newborn and 2 years old, by the numbers that we read here in this passage, already had the local king hunting him down to take him out. Whoa. I mean, that doesn't happen to the average carpenter's son, folks. But if you knew beyond a shadow of a doubt that someone was coming to kill your child tomorrow, would that be sufficient motivation for you to scoop up your child and a few belongings and make a journey of 500 miles? I'm guessing it probably would. The point is, we'd do it if an angel came and told to us that that's what was going to happen. That's what was needed to save our child. We would do it. And that's what Joseph and Mary did. Now, do you notice that they didn't argue with God? I mean, Joseph didn't say, "Hey, God, this is really, you know, your kid, so you protect him," right? No, they followed the promptings of God. They listened to the angel, and in faith, they obeyed. So what would motivate you to make a journey of 500 miles on foot over rugged terrain. Joseph and Mary were motivated first by the angel's message, but even more importantly, by their love for Jesus and their faith in God. They acted in faith, faith that what was coming would actually happen, and faith that God would take care of them along the way as they obeyed. Now, let's take a look for a few minutes at the journey of the Magi. Scripture says, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea during the time of King Herod, Magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, "Where is the one who has been born King of the Jews? We saw his star when it rose and have come to worship him." You know, there's a lot of mystery in and around the story of the Magi, a lot of different ideas about who these guys were, where they came from, even how many of them were there, what their names were. So what do we know for sure? Well, according to Matthew, we know they were, first of all, from the east. Now, many Bible scholars suggest they were most likely from Persia and the area around Babylon, about 600 miles to the east of Bethlehem. In the days of the great King Solomon, people, including kings and queens from all over the ancient world, would come to hear Solomon's wisdom and to see the greatness of his kingdom. You know, sometimes they sought him out for his wisdom. Sometimes they came to make an alliance with him. All that to say that seeking out great leaders in distant countries was not unheard of. Now, secondly, we know that they were called Magi, a term usually referring to a group of Persian astrologers or star watchers and scholars. Several Bible scholars believe these Magi had been following the prophecies of Daniel from his time in Babylon hundreds of years earlier. And we know, according to the Magi's own testament, that they were following a quote-unquote star or some heavenly phenomenon, which they believed indicated the birth of a great king of the Jews. And finally, we know that they were people of faith and character. Scripture says they saw his star when it rose and came to worship him. So these Magi were people of faith. They were also people of character. They didn't come sneaking into the country to try to find Jesus, but rather they went straight to the capital and to the king. And one final way we know of their faith and character is that they listened to the warning God delivered to them and left without returning to Herod. These Magi were motivated by some element of faith that God had instilled in them through the prophecies and signs that they had been watching. So motivated that they were willing to pack up gifts and their belongings and supplies and make a journey of possibly 600 miles or more. So they did all that to go and see a baby that they didn't even know. How many of us would do that? This trip for them was optional. They didn't have to go. Like Mary and Joseph had to flee to Egypt, they could have stayed where they were and saved a whole lot of money on that trip. Now let's bring this all down to some application of faith for us this Christmas season. It generally doesn't require a lot of faith to maintain the status quo, to keep doing what we're doing. It takes a whole lot more faith to move, to radically change our current mode of operations to help someone else. As you're considering what gifts you'll be giving and receiving this Christmas, I'd like to challenge you to consider giving to Jesus the gift of your faith, faith to move. I asked you earlier, what would motivate you to make a journey of 500 miles on foot over rugged terrain? Let me ask you this. What would motivate you to make a journey of 50 feet to your neighbor's door to offer a word of encouragement? Or what would motivate you to pick up the phone or write a post or a postcard to a family member or old friend and encourage them with God's love for them? What would motivate you to give sacrificially of your time, talents, and resources for the sake of others in a local, regional, or global missions context? Why would people do any of that? Faith. Faith is what puts feet to our love. It was faith that enabled Peter to step out of the boat and start walking on the water toward Jesus. And it's that same faith that enables us to step out of our comfort zone. It's that same faith that enables us to step out of our comfort zone, walk over to our neighbors, or to pick up the phone and engage in a conversation with someone we might not normally call, or to give of ourselves in a way that is out of our comfort zone. Our faith carries God's love to the world because we are relying on Him, not us, not on our own power, but on Him. Make no mistake about it, it wasn't Peter's power or ability that enabled him to walk on the water. No, it was the miraculous power of God that enabled him to do so. But it was Peter's faith that was the element needed for Peter to experience God's power in that moment. So I want to challenge you and encourage you to step out of the boat, step out of your comfort zone, and walk in faith. Now, for some of us, that's going to mean trusting God with our whole life, really trusting Him, admitting for the very first time that we're not in control of this world. We're not even in control of our own lives, letting God take over, take the driver's seat, take the steering wheel. And if that's where you're at, I'd strongly encourage you to do three things today, as in, Do them before you put your head on the pillow tonight. Number one, spend some time talking to God about your decision. Number two, circle this day on your calendar at home or on your electronic calendar or wherever, December 6th, 2020, because this very well could be your rebirth day, starting over, starting fresh. And finally, let someone know whom you respect as a mature follower of Christ so they can help you with the next steps of your faith. Now, for some of us, walking in faith is going to mean something different for God's kingdom, something new to you that you've never done before, maybe talking to someone you've never talked to before, maybe going somewhere you've never gone before, and maybe doing something you've never done before. All of those things are steps on our journey of faith. Sometimes they'll be accompanied by our heart fluttering because we know we should do that thing, but it's new. And folks, I imagine that Peter's heart was fluttering like crazy when he stepped out of that boat. So when that happens, pray for God's strength and guidance and go. Let me pray with you today. God, we want to thank you so much for this story from your word. God, we look into the Christmas story and we read it, most of us, and we hear it, most of us, time after again, year after year. And God, I just pray that this year, as we are looking at this story, at the journeys that were made by the people in this story, you will help us to apply those to our own life, our own journey. And God, you will empower us to take that next step of faith on that journey of faith. God, to do something new for you. God, to say something to someone we may never have talked to before. To show act of love, God, in a way that maybe we have never done before. Help us to live in a way that is pleasing to you as we walk this journey of faith. God, we pray these things in your precious name. Amen. The next phase of your journey begins now. May God empower you with each step you take.